got a great presentation for you tonight. We got Garrett Miller of MapBox. He's going to share with us what he's been working on in terms of mobile development with Apache Cordova, or PhoneGap, as some of you may know it, along with backbon.js. So I'm really excited to hear what he's been working on. And with that, I'll give it up to Garrett.
Cool. Hey guys. So you got the high level. We can talk about building mean text, which is currently an iPhone app, but technically could be an anything mobile app because of Cordova. So I'm going to be touching on kind of the story behind building that, basically joining up with MapBox to these guys here. Right when I joined, this is the first project I worked on, and it was around the time that we were talking about what to work on first. So it was kind of time that way. A little bit of myself. My name is Garrett. Hey, it's Garrett on Twitter. Garrett Miller, as you've heard. And I used to work until about a couple months ago at Opower for the last 5 years. It's an energy efficiency startup out in Arlington. I was a front-end dev there, kind of hired as early stage designer. And started working more and more in software until I became a full-fledged software engineer there. That kind of scopes a little bit of how I'm approaching the talk tonight. I do both design and development, so I like to kind of hook a line in this presentation tonight because I don't know what everyone's background is, and it's web development. I'm going to focus mostly on code, but a little bit on the product design and just kind of high level like that. Also, during the time I was at Opower, I started this game with a couple other guys that I called Doodle or Die, which is a node.js project. I don't know if anyone's played it, but you should. It's a lot of fun. It's just kind of it's a drawing game. I began telling them the drawing with doodling. And it's a lot of fun to build, so I spent a lot of time designing the user experience for that, writing a lot of the front-end code, and just kind of going to that. And now I'm at MapBox, and that's what the talk is tonight is about. MapBox is about 3 blocks north of here. We are a map utility company, very small, about 30 people now. And we basically, we serve maps just like Google Maps do. We're a lot of clients, both mobile and mobile on the web, all over the place. And so, story of MeetText is when I joined, I was talking to Young here, and I was kind of thinking about something that would be good to learn MapBox on. MapBox has a MapBox.js, which is an open source library. It allows you to kind of build maps quickly using MapBox tiles or any tiles, really. And so they had this idea that this is about 2 weeks before South by Southwest. It would be really fun to build a mobile app built on top of this one guy's idea, which is called MeetText. This guy, Bobby Sudekum, had created this iPhone Android app called MeetText. It was very basic. It's the exact same thing that I'll be talking about tonight. He built this app. There's an easy way to share your location. So we, MapBox, acquired Bobby and therefore acquired MeetText, and they wanted to rebuild it using MapBox tiles instead of Google and adding a little bit of personality and flair to it. So MeetText is pretty much just that. It's a it's an app for quickly sharing your location with anyone, kind of getting them to come and find you. Talk tonight is going to be touching on like how we built that using Backbone.js and Cordova. As Andrew said, Cordova and PhoneGap, I don't really know the story. Maybe someone here has a better idea of what it is, but it's I think it was called PhoneGap since 2008, and then Apache acquired it, open sourced it, but now it's PhoneGap / Cordova. And what it is a, does anyone here know what Cordova is or no?
Oh, well.
Okay. Cordova is basically just a way to build, to use WebView to actually build mobile applications. So basically, it has a bunch of hooks into what native application would use, and just renders WebView inside of that. Some background myself, I have absolutely no iOS experience. I still have no iOS experience. I've spent a weekend with it and failed miserably. So anyone here who has iOS experience is doing better than I. And as of now, I have 2 weeks experience with Backbone.js and Cordova. So anyone here who has touched either of those things probably has just as much, if not more, experience than I do with that. What I'm going to be talking about tonight is really kind of how I approach that, not knowing anything about it, and kind of how it worked for us. So, it's a little bit about other applications and how they use sharing. This is the problem that Bobby was solving when he made MeetText the first one about a year ago. I think this will work quite quick. This is just a screen capture of Apple. So this is Apple's Android Maps. You go there, the share location is hidden away, and then you can mail it from there. Apple also has Find My Friends, who also have iPhones, basically. Find My Friends, I don't know if anyone here has iPhones or uses Find My Friends. I think I use it with the three other engineering friends who have iPhones. Just a way for you to see your friends' locations on map and share that way. Foursquare does a lot of this too. I remember I used to find my friends one time to tell my friend to come to a party. I used the Brushes app and brought it in. That was about the closest I got to trying to share my location with a friend. Google has its own option. This is just for dash because I'm lazy. You go in there, you place a pin, you scroll through the menu, you can find a way to share your location right around there. So again, pretty basic. And that's really what applications, what any application, mobile application should really be about, is finding a singular purpose, focus on that, and build it out. So with MeetText, we want to make something that was easy, quick, and fun. What that means is it's really easy to share your location. This is the one purpose of the app. You don't want to get in the way of that. And ultimately, if we're going to get this launched for South by Southwest, with people running all over the place, going to bars and things, we just wanted a way for them to, bar none, share location very fast. And the fun was because one thing MeetText looked pretty basic. What Bobby had built is very functional, but kind of boring. If you're going to build an app that it's really a marketing tool, then you want it to have a little bit of personality. And so we wanted to make it fun. But as I said, South by Southwest was only 2 weeks away. And the thing about this is that Apple, they on their website they list how long it takes to how long the review process is taking when you submit an app for the first time. At the time, it was reading about 6 days. So we had 6 days until, you know, after we submitted an app to actually have it in the App Store, which meant that we really only had about 6 days to build the entire app to a point where we could submit it. So we had a lot of late nights discussing this. But I think I remember one of those late nights, we talked about what it should be, like what this should be. How can we make maps compelling? And it was pretty much create the Instagram of maps. So we wanted to just create a very singularly focused experience that's fun and does that, and we had to build it in 6 days. So I set to work right away. I sketched out some wireframes, and these are, I'm really glad I saved these because you can kind of see how much we scrapped in 6 days. Right away we started with authentication because that's a great way to find and share with your friends. We had a search, we had a bunch of other things on there, and ultimately, we realized that what we needed to do was come up with just a minimum viable product. We only had 6 days. We had to really par down what it was, but we had to think what was important. So this is the initial spec that one of our designers came up based on what I put together. You see there's a search bar at the top, but ultimately, everything's pretty basic. Excuse me. We wanted the app itself, like we wanted the maps and the markers to be the number one focus. MeetText is ultimately going to be a big marketing play at South by Southwest for MapBox and how easy it is to customize your maps. And this is my little corporate shilling going on right now. MapBox is really, really great at customizing maps and styling them. And so ultimately we wanted to shut it off. And we wanted the app to be fun doing it. So the UI is pretty quiet and the maps and the markers can speak themselves. And then on the receiving end, what your friend would receive is something like this. This is a UI spec. Message, marker, map, and we had a reply button at the time, so we thought it'd be fun to do messaging, and realized that was a whole can of worms that we didn't want to open. But this also had to be responsive. I'm not going to talk too much about this because everyone knows about responsive design and kind of what that is, but this is just basically an HTML page that ultimately takes in a URL hash. So you pass all the variables through the URL, HTML, it fills out that, even the Latin law of the map, the style of the map and the marker itself, it's all passed to the URL. This was the very minimum level product. We're not doing any user authentication, we're not doing any cookies, we're not doing anything like that. So technically you could change any one of the URLs just by changing the variables there. We had our own shortener to meettext.com, so you know, when your friend gets the link, it's not some ungodly long thing, it's just a very basic little meettext link. The routing right there, MapBox doesn't do routing, so unfortunately we have a little route button that does go to Google, but only for the routing there. So implementation, I'll jump around a little bit, again, because I don't know exactly what everyone's background is, but we'll talk about Cordova first. So you know the history, like PhoneGap's been around since 2008. I don't know when Apache acquired them or how that went down, but it's basically HTML, CSS, and JavaScript rendering. And it takes the web view of any one of the mobile devices you're on and renders that through the device's native hooks. What you can do is supplement with plugins. And so MapBox, or VTex rather, has plugins that, I think there's an SMS composer which hooks into messaging on iOS. It has a Twitter and a Facebook host. So these people are open sourcing these and adding them. But basically, you just have a native shell that you can add plugins to. So if you want to go into, we haven't done it yet, and this is really one thing stopping us. If we wanted to go release an Android app, all we have to do is hook up those plugins and get them working here. There's a couple things that we need to do on our end to get Android to work correctly, which is really what's holding us back. But Cordova is a pretty good library of doing these things. A little history, like when I heard that we wanted to build something with PhoneGap, I think I looked at PhoneGap about 2 years ago and seen a couple of their sample apps, and I wasn't impressed. So I was a little worried about what we were going to be trying to do here. I had only heard bad things, but I, again, 6 days to build something, none of us knew how to code native Objective C. So I rolled with it, and plus Cordova had rebranded and had a really great logo, so that kind of sold me. this is basically what the file structure of the Xcode project is. It really was an Xcode project that hosted the Cordova code. There are cool things in the www folder there, though. And that is really where the meat of the app is, and this is kind of where we did some tricky things. Cordova.js is the native Cordova library. Loading.gif is something that we'll hear through in just to create that little spinner when you're loading up an app. And the index.html is really where the meat of the app is. The entire app essentially lives in this index.html because we just have a JavaScript in there that points, in this case it's pointing to my local host when I'm developing, it just points to a URL. So the whole app was actually just a shell for an external URL. And we were really worried about this. We heard this is what people had done in the past in order to get Cordova apps in there fast. And what this allows you to do is basically just render any, you could have this point to google.com if you wanted to, but for us we wanted to point it to metext.com/ the version of the app that we're working on. This essentially just creates one big Trojan horse. This is the term that we kept throwing around. We wanted to keep quiet, but basically we submitted, we created a very simple app that pointed to metext.com, and all it was a very basic version of what you saw before. I'll go back to that so it's not too distracting. what you saw before is a very basic version of the initial metext app that Bobby had built a year ago. And it just pointed to metext.com/v1 rather than the initial version. And this is what we submitted to Apple, and we had to wait 6 days. And the entire thing getting it ready for South by Southwest was hinged on them actually accepting this, and they accepted it. So we've heard people getting denied about this. They accepted ours, which is great because once they did that, we were able to basically just render any view we wanted on metext.com. We could push updates whenever we wanted to. So when we actually had the app ready, we'd be able to just push to that. The app wouldn't have to get an update. We wouldn't have to do anything with that. It was really cool because we knew that there'd be bugs. We knew we were moving fast and that it was going to get a little bit ugly. So back to development. This was one of the very initial screenshots. I knew this talk was coming up, so I started taking screenshots of the process as I was going along. It's the same view, and the cool thing about building for this is when you have the iOS simulator running, you can just run it in Safari. You have to account for the fact that those bars won't be there in the actual app, but it allows you to build really fast and test on the actual mobile application. But it's exactly the same as rendering it in a web view. So this initial version of what it looked like. And before I go further, I wanted to do an actual live demo of the app so that when I talk about things, you have something to refer to. So have it up here. Great. This. Oh, you can see I even made my background special for you guys. So this is the app right here. Color's a little off the monitor, but this is the app as you would see it if you downloaded it today. The iOS simulator is a little confused about where it is, and so we default to San Francisco if it can't find your location. Otherwise, it just uses a browser's geolocation to find where you are. Everything you're seeing is a web view here. These are Mapbox maps. This is all live. So basically, when you load the app up, finds your location, throws a pin down there, and you could very easily just quickly share your location with someone through any one of these means. These are the three buttons that I was talking about that hook into the native application. This hooks into the applicant into iOS's mail. This hooks into iOS's built-in Twitter integration. This hooks into Clipboard, and this hooks into messaging. But the fun thing that we did was we allowed you to actually theme the map. And this is the thing we wanted to use to kind of showcase, how fast the internet will be, yep. Showcase kind of how Mapbox maps can be styled really easily. And we had an animator on the staff, which meant that we could have a lot of fun with markers. This is the first time I ever worked with an animator, and we had an amazing designer illustrator make these guys, and then 2 hours later, suddenly they would be animated and doing these crazy things, and it was just awesome. That's the nature of the app. The other thing we did is built in Foursquare integration. Foursquare uses Mapbox maps, and so we rely pretty heavily on their API whenever we can. It's a great business search, so anyone who's ever trying to look for kind of a great API for doing geolocation in businesses, Foursquare is really robust. What it does is it looks at the panel, we give it like 200 meters around geolocation, and you can cycle through, find the places that you want to place a pin, place a marker there. So that's kind of behind the scenes. This is the geolocation. I think it'll just go to where it thinks you should be. So that's it. That's the app. It's pretty simple. This works great. It's pretty simple, but there's a lot going on behind the scenes. So this was my, in case this doesn't work. And here we are. So on the front end, basically it's all one view. It's all one big HTML page, one big JavaScript page. And what we do is everything is absolute positioned. So you have the main viewport here, these absolute position boxes on top. And then outside of the view are basically, there's a div here, it's 320 pixels tall, and then this idea of a header here, and then this is that second screen that you saw when you slide in. So everything is actually in the view, just positioned absolute off the screen. And the reason I did this is because most web views, to do kind of the fancy animation that iOS, that you see in iOS a lot, you have to have the divs actually present on the page. And so we put them here. This is a scrolling div, and I'll talk a little bit about that a little bit later, but this is the just the main view of the page. And that's all rendered using Backbone. So Backbone, I think I started building, and I was just building some basic JavaScript stuff, and Will here came and asked me if I heard of Backbone, which I heard of it but never touched it. And basically what it is a model in view. Has anyone actually used Backbone here? No? Okay. Good. it's a model in view, and instead of having your data tied into the DOM where you have to use jQuery to look at data attributes where you have to either store your cookies or sessions, what it does is it turns the data into an actual model that's accessed through JavaScript. So it listens through for attribute changes to this model and then updates the page. So when the model changes, the view changes, and that's kind of the magic of what's going on here is that it's got a lot of great stuff going on behind the scenes that makes it really easy to hook up anything changing in the view. And it makes it really great for mobile development. Mobile development's all about interaction and storing data quickly and fast and moving through these things. So Backbone actually worked out really well for us. I was warned about the size of this TV. I think you guys can probably all see it, but the code I'm going to be speaking to is hosted on a gist here, in case anyone wanted to open up. I think we'll be okay. I think it's a bit bigger. Let me know if you can't read the code. So, on the main JavaScript file on that on the MeText view, this is essentially what's hosted at metext.com/v1. You can actually go to that URL now too when you have the app on the browser. This is the just basic init function. We pass Cordova so it knows if you're trying to render it through Cordova or through web view. If you're rendering through Cordova, we pass it through there. We store the backbone model right in this variable post. And that's just that right there just creates the entire model. And we pass that to the view. So editor right here is a view. We assign it the model post, and if you pass along the element of the body where you want to be doing a lot of these interactions, and you pass along Cordova, it's true. And this is that view declaration a little bit further down in the page. You can go look at the, if any of you actually end up looking at this GIF, I'll send out the URL later, but if you need to actually look at it, I apologize, because it's a very long JavaScript file. You basically just started hacking over, and when things are close to the deadline, you keep going on, but the meat of it's all there. And in the view declaration, you can basically, it just extends the background view through there. So, back to the init. The first really cool thing when I talked about how when attributes change, Backbone listens for and updates the thing, it's all set through these set through these these model attributes. So right on the init, the four things that we set, the theme, marker, and message. The theme is the map thing that you saw, marker is the little animation, and the message is the default message that you want, that your friend might see when you pass along the map. Timestamp, I don't know if we'll be able to, I think we just kept track of that for later, because when you actually do submit it, we update the timestamp with when you're submitting it, so they know how long ago you sent it. We assign, I think there's about another 20 things that are assigned to the model here, but these are the first initial things. And what's great about this is whenever you change that, you know, you have it stored globally so you can access any point. So something like this, this model get marker. We had an array of markers at the top, basically it was just an associative array. So in this case, coffee pointed to the URL for where this coffee guy was stored at. You could do that get theme, get latmon, and that was really what's cool, is anytime you update any of those things, you have it stored in one place. And then, this is kind of the meat of why it's great for mobile. Events. So, Backbone has a whole list of events, the things like clicks, presses, anything changes, anything added. There's a whole bunch of things you can do here. You can actually write your own custom events, and that's what pushes. Pushes is word just to capture either a click or a tap. I'll talk a little about why that's tricky. I don't know if anyone's built for mobile before, but tap is different than a click, and not all browsers treat taps the same. So events here are great because you can just tie in one place. You can tie any interaction to any other function. So you can see things like pinpoint within or run the geolocate function, which is run at the beginning anyway. Share button moves into that one screen. And so in one place, instead of having a bunch of on-clicks stored out anywhere in the code, like you move it a lot of times to jQuery, things like that, it's a little sloppy, throws it all into one place. And it's great for keeping track of kind of what's going on and how things are getting called. And then attribute changes. So this is you have the ideas of theme or any of those attributes that I declared before. You can actually listen for when those are changed, so you don't actually have to run a function again. You can choose which functions to change whenever that attribute is changed. So if I actually change if I use a model set and change the theme to a different style, this is what listens to change the thing. I don't actually have to call that function down in the code when I do it. I set that attribute again. Backbone knows that it's been set, and then goes and runs this function again. So I don't run theme from that click event. I just run it up here. And this is really powerful. I'm barely touching the surface of like a lot of the stuff, partly because I haven't played more with it. But what's cool is, for instance, the change lat and change lon. The map itself has stores of error for latitude and longitude. So if you ever see, where is that simulator? I hate this theme though, so let's go back to basic. So if I'm here and I want my friend to go over to the park here, I have a listener right here. And a lot of things just happen that click and help this. So I have a timeout there that listens for how long it's been pressed. And then once it's pressed, I think for 300 milliseconds, I go and I do a pin drop. And what that is I basically, all I did there was once the timeout ran out, I changed the lat and lon to where the press was going on there. And then Backbone heard that change, went and ran the pin drop function, which actually erases all the markers on the map, goes and drops that one marker right there. And it's really cool because it means that you're no longer having to keep track of where these two click events are happening. Backbone is actually listening for what's going on there. So every time it's going on, a lot of things are running. You can also see right here, I have a listener for when it changes to run Foursquare again. So every time you click it, it runs Foursquare within 200 meters there and finds the new location. So you can see that's what's going on there. I'm doing a call to Foursquare's API. It's finding those 10 businesses or however many businesses around there. You go in there, and you can also better place your pin if you really want them to meet you at this one bar or this one place. That goes back to, you know, basically the whole point of the app is to quickly share your location, and oftentimes you're trying to share a venue rather than an actual geolocation. So that's what's going on here. These are all just functions listening to those attribute changes. So, all that said, there are some gotchas. This is the fun part, this is what I call animated GIFs. So, like any web, any kind of development, there's and kind of hacking like this too. This whole thing is, as you can tell, is very hacked together. So there's a lot of gotchas with kind of building for web views that you don't get when you build native, because you're building for one view. position absolutely fixed. I talked a little bit about this when I pointed to this. A lot of web views, you actually have to position absolute things. So everything is right here, this is positioned absolute 0, 0. These guys right here are actually positioned absolute 10,000 pixels to the top, just in case you're on a device that has 10,000 pixel, you know, who knows, but those are positioned way out there. And that actually leads into the next point, which is that CSS transforms. CSS3, you transform anything. I was gonna include a YouTube video here, but it'd be a little clunky, but basically, when you do a CSS transform on mobile, you might see this if you ever go to a page that has them. It kind of jumps around. It's very jerky, and it immediately takes you out of the native experience. And the solution to that is use Translate3D. Translate3D is just basically hooks in a 3D rendering engine rather than the graphics accelerator. And that allows, and so here's a quick example of how I did it. It's a very ugly, long line of code, but I have this wrapper for nearby, which you saw whenever I ran Foursquare. I animated it, this is just using the jQuery animation function. I should note that Backbone is not reliant on jQuery or Zepto, which is a lightweight version of jQuery. It's not reliant on that at all, I just use it because I like it. You can build just native Backbone if you want. But I use the jQuery animation function, I translate it here, and I moved up 44 pixels, which is how high the bar was. And then I had a global variable for speed, which was kind of unnecessary in hindsight, but I had it. And then this is one of the big ones with Backbone. This is something that Will pointed out to me. This is not always this. So what you see here is modest maps. This is the mapping engine that we built on top of. So ignore that part. But basically, when you run a function here, you lose context of what this is. Function has its own context for this. This is part of the JavaScript scoping. So Backbone is based. It's relying on _js, and what you can do is all well here. You can just bind this, so you can actually bind the models. This keeps track of everything you have, every model attribute you have. So you can actually pass this in and overwrite the functions this, and that's just basically those two things right there. You just attach an underscore function and bind this to it. What it means is that you can actually hook into that. If you don't want to do that, you can actually just pass it. This is just as hacky, but you can actually just assign a local variable to this.model, call model, and then inside the function, you can call anything on it, and it'll still listen for those sets. If you're building for iOS, the maximum file size in WebView on anything with over 500 megabytes of RAM, which I think is iPhone 4 or higher, so iPhone 3G and iPhone 3GS are only 256 megabytes of RAM, but maximum file size in WebView is 5 megapixels, which basically means if you look at an image width time height has to be less than 5 times 1024 by 1024, and like I said, if it's less than 256 megabytes of RAM, it's 3 megapixels. This was the reason we found out this is because all those animated markers you see are actually PNGs. We thought we really wanted them to be transparent so they can sit on top of the map in interesting ways. Because of that, we didn't want to do GIFs. GIFs are actually also huge. If anyone's ever made an animated GIF, they can be really huge. And with PNGs, you can actually compress and just do a static image. And then we basically have the PNG in a div, and we cycle through using an animation function. But this was important because we got to the point where we had 25,000 pixel wide images, and they wouldn't render on the PNG. So that's a gotcha that probably won't get too many people, but FYI, you can save yourself an hour. And one last thing is elastic scrolling. When you're actually scrolling a div on iOS and Android too, actually, they have their own hooks for how an overflow scroll should work. So you can pass along a touch thing here. And what that does is it just creates a nice smooth, that kind of bouncy scroll you get. And all this is really important because what it does is when you're using an app, and you can actually tell. This is why I was so hard on PhoneGap earlier. I was using apps that didn't account for any of this, or the stuff didn't exist yet. So you could really tell that you're on an app that was just really janky. It was just, it looks like it's broken. It doesn't feel fluid. An app should feel fast and fluid. So there's similar hooks for other devices. And then the most annoying was the tap delay. So 3 millisecond tap delay, which is also related to ghost clicks. Basically, this is when on any web view, this doesn't happen native, but on any web view, they create a 300 delay, so they make sure that you actually want to tap there rather than you're trying to scroll or do something else. And so, and because of that, if you click and they're not sure, there's also ghost clicks. If you tap something, a div moves away. The div moved away in a faster 300 milliseconds, also you have a ghost click, so it clicks again. And we fix it just with plugins. I use Zepto for Backbone, and this is another reason why I like Zepto or jQuery. There's plugins there that basically what they do is they override the browser's 300 millisecond delay. Both Android and iOS have this delay, so you have to override them. And once you do, you find that immediately it's just much more zippy. So the OnPress plugin that I used, just right there, it just hooks in like any other jQuery extension. And then what I did is that Backbone, I don't know if you remember, but I had in the events I had the push event declaration, and this is actually where we triggered that custom event. All we're doing is triggering that push and passing along the event to it, and the OnPress listens for that event. So OnPress is overriding the event, because we push that to Backbone via push. And then I had a funky bug where I was it was working some of the time and always, so I just completely nuked the event after that point. So I stopped propagation and prevented default, which just kills the click there. This is really like kind of the tip of the iceberg with a lot of this stuff. There's a ton of resources out there with kind of both mobile web development, mobile development gotchas, but also just like building a backbone. I was really worried that there'd be a backbone expert in the group and I would just be talking to someone about something. This is just the surface of backbone. So I don't claim to be an expert on it, but I can tell you like what my experience was with it. And that basically just ended up with MeTeX. So I encourage you all to go, if you have an iPhone, go and download MeTeX. If you don't have an iPhone, wait for us to get the Android version out. Or go to metex.com/v1 so you can just see how it all kind of goes on behind the scenes. And if you want to reach out to me, yeah, animations. Hey, it's Garrett on Twitter, and there's metex.com. Those are some of the animated GIFs that we actually made out of the images. So, thanks. Thank you. Take questions or comments or insults.
So you said you'd have to do some work to get it to work on Android.
Yeah.
I know you haven't done it yet, but do you know what that would be?
Yeah. So the overflow, there's one weird bug where the overflow wasn't always coming up the exact right amount. I think it's just a lot of this stuff is just same thing you find with any browser query.
This is just very minor.
Yeah, very minor. And then the big thing which I hinted at is that we have to get the Cordova plugins working. We almost have them working. We just had to get the, like, if you go back to, where's the app right here? You know, like I said, all four of these actions right here are built-in native, so iOS 6, you know, comes with this built-in Twitter, you know, Twitter's baked in now, so it hooks into that. Android has its own versions of that, so we need to actually pass that along.
And so how does that work when you download a plugin from Cordova and you have to wrap it with, or, you know, they have an Android one and an Apple one, and you guys would wrap it with your own?
Yeah, so basically, yeah, here's Cordova here. I know it's going to be really hard to read, but basically, over here, where are they? Yeah, here they are, plugins. You just have these plugins here, and then within the Cordova code, I wasn't handling this, and this is what the other guys were doing, but it's pretty much, yeah, you just choose which plugin you want to run. Both, one of these is Android, one of these is, you just run through those. And yeah, that's pretty much the meat of it. On Windows phones, I actually tried, I loaded the web version of, you know, mapbox.com/v1. I loaded that onto a BlackBerry, my girlfriend's BlackBerry. That was really, sorry, it's hard to type in. Look. So I loaded this on my girlfriend's BlackBerry and it actually worked, which is really cool. And I'm sure it was like this big, yeah. And that's the other thing I didn't talk about, which is that the height here is variable, but a lot of these, like, you know, this is 44 pixels right here, this is 44 pixels right here. A lot of this is very much based on like how an iPhone app sizes, even though it doesn't really look like an iPhone app. So because of that, it's there's probably some things you could do with CSS and JavaScript, which make it a little bit more native. It's a simple app with a lot going on behind it, but I think if you create like your own, you know, unique UI experiences, it's not so bad. But yeah, I think that's pretty much it. And then I think
have you tried opening it in non-Chrome browsers?
Yeah, I ran it in Firefox and it blew up. So Firefox hates the position fixed negative 10,000 pixels. Again, I haven't looked into it. That's probably a bug fix too. Yeah.
I probably missed this earlier on, but I know that PhoneGap is based on Cordova.
Yeah.
What are the differences that that I guess Adobe adds?
Yeah, I couldn't tell you. I think they just what they as far as I could tell and as far as I got, I did some research today even on this because I wanted to be better informed. Because basically I just wrote what we got. As far as I can tell, they have a shinier label on it, and they maintain the actual plugin libraries a little bit more. I think they just opened up a repository for where all these things are stored. But I couldn't tell you the difference between what PhoneGap does and what Cordova does. I think PhoneGap is the open source library on it, and Cordova closes some things off.
Cordova is the Apache project.
It's the Apache project.
So PhoneGap was an open source project. Adobe came along, hired all the developers, and before they were hired, they jettisoned the open source off to Apache Foundation. And that's Cordova, and PhoneGap is now the trademarks owned by Apache.
Interesting.
Or sorry, Adobe. Yeah.
Adobe.
Same number.
So PhoneGap and Cordova are essentially
they're the same.
Yeah.
For now.
Interesting. Yeah.
So I was curious. You know, one bit of user experience I have a problem with on a mobile device is, you know, especially around DC and the subway tunnels or whatever, that you only have a little bit of cellular service.
Yeah.
Using this app, wouldn't I just get a spinner until I get to the next metro station?
Yeah, absolutely.
And have you had any plans to take some of the content and have it be at least partially native until you get to the service level?
So then there's like there's two things going on there. The one thing is serving up Mapbox maps itself. Yeah. Like, there's no way you could have, you know, we'd have the capacity to store. Other, I mean, I guess, you know, what a lot of mapping applications do, I was reading about this, they do store like certain amounts of data for a certain range, you know, up to a mile or so. So you can do some load, so it's not so weird when you're loading.
There could even be caching there too.
Yeah, exactly. So you could cache, I guess you could essentially cache that. The tricky thing would be the geolocation. So I guess if you open up the app, you could easily, you know what you could do is you just cache that, object itself in the server, and then hopefully they wouldn't zoom in, because then you would have to do another. I mean, you could do things like probably prevent zoom.
Sure, but even the framework elements, the different graphics that are
That would all be cached in the web view. So Cordova does cache that. So I think if I were to close the application and reopen it,
yeah,
that would cache. And I actually didn't mention this. So we have that right now. The app is sitting in the App Store, but it's still pointing to a hard URL. So yes, you would get a spinner. We're planning on packaging it up and just packaging the whole thing, which means all the assets are also local, which is great because those animated PNGs, I think they're about like 50 each, which is pretty cool. That big animation, only 50 kilobytes, but they load way faster when it's local. So you can actually do that. The way we did it with the Trojan Horse thing was also kind of shady, and I can't verify that it'd work every time. But you can easily wrap up all the assets.
Yeah,
and we would be doing that. It's just right now. You know, we're not sure about the bugginess. We haven't had time to work on it, so it was really great because we were still fixing bugs. Like South by Southwest started on Saturday, we were still fixing bugs the following Tuesday, and like pushing them live. So it worked out really well, and actually, like, it's pretty cool to be able to like push an update to an app as shady as it is. Push an update to an app and, like, silently. People really don't update either. I think Apple's—they finally worked in new push notifications for when your apps need updating. I have friends that looked at their phones and they have like 118 updates waiting. So it's like people don't update their phones. So it's kind of nice to have something like this where you can like update for them.
Aside from your comments on the tap and ghost clip, rather, I've never developed for a mobile browser.
Yeah.
And the touch interface. Is there anything else that are best practices?
So a lot of the stuff I didn't talk about was a lot of interaction, because I know there's a lot of coders here. Interactions themselves, there's tons of plugins for multi-touch and things like that. You know, the web browsers give you hooks into those, but there's a lot of both jQuery and other plugins for actually listening for those if you want to do custom interaction with the swipes. I think there's one that's great. It's called Hammer Time, or Hammer.js. I don't know if you've ever heard of that. But I haven't played with it. I've heard good things. it's basically it has a so you can see like it has hooks in for like swipe left, swipe right, two finger, and that's stuff I would actually really love to play with. You see a lot of people are using Cordova and plugins like this for doing for building games and just building a really quick web game that works really well with touch, so you can build games roll out across the board. I think it's become one thing. I'm looking for more apps that use Cordova. in a big way. Backbone worked for us because we just, you know, it's very much about the view. So we make one view that just has, you know, multiple functions. It works really well. I would like to see a Cordova app that goes really like in depth at Cordova and, you know, with web views and things like that. Because that's where you get that URL loading. You got to see anything that knows what's going on. But there's no control over there because it just hooks into the API, with the MapBox API and Foursquare one.
If you're not a developer, but a little company in DC and related mobile stuff, I was watching this really funny YouTube video. Brian Rowe, he's on the Cordova team, mm-hmm. works for Adobe. And he said, well, the Cordova group's really making a big push toward device APIs.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, API for sensors, API for the camera, API. He said they develop one for the battery, which would constantly be to save the battery, but the API itself killed the battery. Anyway, device APIs seem to be the next big focus. I was wondering, so one of, a good example we had was having a web page that showed you your device's camera mm-hmm. live, like a web page, which was cool.
Yeah, so it's just you're holding it up and it's rendering it.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the stuff that'd be really cool with games.
Yeah. So just, my question was, is that something that, you know, you feel as a developer might be able
to? Yeah, I mean, absolutely. Like, I think the whole plugin thing is kind of broken, that we have to go and find these plugins that other people are writing in order to build a mobile app. I mean, right now, this is my very first mobile application I built. We've been actually, you know, anecdotally, we've been trying to build a mobile app for Doodle or Die, and so that's where I was getting my feet. I was getting my feet dirty and like iOS stuff, and it was just so far above my head. And so, like, once I played with this mobile app, you know, assuming I had any free time, I would definitely hop in and start doing that. And it, as far as device APIs go, I think that's kind of the obvious next step. They need to make it easier and less, like, it's kind of a weird process to have a bunch of plugins you have to then go and put your statements around in order to call.
He was raving about this project called the Boutique Gecko. You remember that?
Yeah. I'm going to hear about
it's
that.
Like a web OS.
Yeah. Ubuntu is, well, they're also working. We just installed it yesterday. Their new touch Ubuntu is rolling out that new, yeah, the Gecko touch. So I installed it yesterday. It's, it needs a lot of work. it was funny, they actually have JPEGs in place of like where a game would be, like, so they had like C Safari, which is an iOS game, and they just put a JPEG in for the app, so you wouldn't try to click it, it's just a static image. It took me a while to figure out what the scroll events were. I think in the next couple of years you're going to see a lot more mobile. It's all mobile first, right?
So you say you only have it for iOS right now?
Yeah, and it's honestly, it's probably like a day. Everything works on Android. There's just a few weird user interactions, and then the messaging won't work. The messaging isn't working right now. We need to figure out why that is.
Because that's one of the things I've been interested in developing with web views and JavaScript, because you get the cross-platform.
Right.
But you know, PhoneGap has this thing called the build, where they build on the cloud, and you just write your code, you put it up there, and it's ready for all the platforms. And I was just wondering if you have done that and why.
Yeah. There's something stopping us from it, other than we have a 2-week window to build this, and we focused on iOS because that's what we want to do. But it was actually kind of like, it's kind of dumb not to just roll it out on Android too, at least those two, since those are the big players. I tried it on an iPad, worked fine, which was fun. But yeah, I can't imagine a lot of times when you're trying to carry an iPad around and share your location. Yeah, there's nothing stopping us from really doing that, other than devoting a day to it. So I mean, this was really like, the app itself was really built for South by Southwest, just to get the push out there. It's still there. We'll probably like, we have plans, like, we have, I think we have this long list of 100 markers that we'd love to build, but obviously like, there's really no reason to go talk to that right now. But yeah, it's my friends have asked me to, why we haven't built it out on Android. We really should just do that.
Have you played it at all with the difference between this and mm-hmm. like Sencha Touch or something like that?
Yeah, a little bit. Sencha, like, I didn't get too into it. I played with that in my free time a couple months ago, but I didn't play with it anywhere I could remark on how it was. A lot of libraries out there are doing their best to be lightweight. But Zepto is the reason I went Zepto over jQuery is for the same reason, like, looking mobile friendly. Zepto is basically just a lightweight jQuery. It takes out a lot of the browser specific hooks. So it takes out functionality, it tries to account for IE7 think IE8, because it knows that you'll probably be using it on mobile devices, and it maybe takes away, it saves you like 50 kilobytes too. That's kind of moot in this point though, because if we were to package everything in the app, so it wouldn't matter. But yeah, I haven't played with too many other devices, other than knowing that I've loaded it up in a few, I've loaded that URL that I showed you, the meetext.com. I've loaded this URL up on the friend's devices just to see how it goes. And most of the time it's just because, you know, this div right here will just be showing for some reason. And so a lot of it's just browser hooks. That's what's kind of cool about this. It's like, you know, when you build on a mobile device, it's much harder to inspect these things. You have to open up, you know, browser inspector, things like that. It's great because you can actually just open these up in simulators and run them in there. So just building HTML, CSS, and JavaScript is way better for me. I remember when I was working on, when we were working on the doodler.ios device, it killed me that I had to go and recompile everything just to run it again. Like, that's awful. I don't know how people do that. I can't believe that, that people are building successful apps doing this. They're probably just more patient than me. Yeah.
I was just wondering, what do you plan to work on this?
Well, this wrapped up like a month and a half ago.
Okay.
So, what have we done since then? We've done a lot.
Just played a lot of video games.
A lot of video games. Yeah, we don't really do any of my books. Doom. We actually foosball, so we have to get started with that. What have I done in the last couple months? So we moved right on that, and I built some new tools for kind of, they're all kind of tangentially related to MapBox.js. So I built this locator map, so we were working with a way for news organizations to be able to quickly share markers. A lot of times this is awful, but a lot of times news orgs want to have a marker and a map to show like where someone was gunned down. And so we built a little tool to make that easier. So things like that. A lot of it is all related to MapBox.js, so which we're going to be rolling out a new version of soon. I encourage everyone, by the way, like this is you know, the shill in me, but go play with MapBox. It actually is a lot of fun. I, you know, before MeetText, I had played with it at all. It's pretty cool to build on top of maps and build on top of like geolocation. There's a lot to do with that, especially with mobile. You can do a lot. I mean, that's where the games and stuff come into play. If I had any free time, I'd probably be building another Cordova and JavaScript app, just hooking into a lot of those things with Hammer.js and stuff like that, just having fun. If you Google for it, a lot of people have been building some really cool apps and building sprites. They're basically showing how you do game development from the browser. So you see them building like little animated sprites, and like someone showed a, you know, one week demo on how to build an RPG in JavaScript, which is so cool because it works on every browser too. And then they hooked into touch events for that, so just really cool stuff. And the biggest thing you have to worry about is I hinted at this with that. With one of my gotchas is that browser acceleration. You have to worry about memory management, things like that. Since it's all browser and it's all WebView, the WebView has different rules than a native app would have about how much memory you're allowed to use and where you're allowed to access it from. So you have to be pretty smart about not overloading with like loose JavaScript. That's about it.
Can you talk about what you actually did at South by Southwest with the app?
So our CEO was actually one there, and he basically he kept using it. He was showing it. I mean, he used it as, partly as a way to just like have fun and share a fun location. I think his favorite one was those two beers clinking. Yeah, right there. he used it that one a lot. He was basically hopping around different bars. What he was doing was demoing it to a lot of people at MapBox. So like, this was always a marketing play, and we knew that. But he was really trying to show how easy it was just to change the different map styles. All those are rendered on the fly, and just moved along that way. So he was doing that. I think he was just trying to get people to use it. We have a few people actually use it. I mean, it doesn't have to, we never expected it to blow up. It's like a very simple purpose app, and it's very much like a silly thing. But we did have people start using it just to basically share the bars they were at. That's why that beer one was so popular. I use it every now and then just to like tell friends where a party is. But they actually did use it, because when you get the, I'll actually show you what the other view looks like. When they get it on the receiving end, this is it. So this is what you receive. The background image is tied to the theme that you chose. There's a message in the image. It's great because finds where we're at, that's where you want to go. And then you can do the route, which that's what I was saying, it hooks into Google Maps itself. So I used it a couple times to show friends where parties map, but that's about it. I had a bunch of slides that I ended up mixing about like kind of designing an app and like a product design around that. The big thing was finding the personality of what you want to do. Like you can pick the single goal that you want to do, which ours is quickly sharing your location. And then we found a personality for that, which is these silly markers and the map themes, and that was really about it. I think that, you know, like I said, I haven't seen anyone do something really heavy lifting with some of this stuff. I feel like that you'd have to be way smarter about the JavaScript and like how do you organize all that with something big. But this worked really well for a real single purpose app. So, yeah.
I'm sorry if I missed it. MapBox is what's the special niche with MapBox that you want to use something MapBox does that isn't just a Google map?
Oh yeah, so MapBox itself is where I work now. It's basically it's just a map utility for serving maps. We don't have routing, which is why like it kind of sucks that we have to send someone to Google to route to a location. But MapBox is ultimately just a way to quickly like customize and build your own maps. We have a whole API for hooking into both building those maps, but also building the markers on top of them. So we have a marker API. So that marker being placed, there's actually like a pin being dropped on a map. I custom styled it with CSS.
And you can do whatever kind of map you want.
Exactly. So a lot of the people who use MapBox use it for data visualization. Foursquare, like all of Foursquare's site is actually when they share a location. I don't know if they have that window. Yes, so right here is a MapBox map right here, and you can see they have pins dropped on there. I'm here. So that's basically what MapBox is. And so the whole play for VText was when we got the app, we wanted to style the MapBox maps and kind of showcase just different ways to customize it, which is what that whole which is what this screen was all about. We about, I think 12 different themes, 9 different themes that style maps in really crazy ways. So that's what the big play was there. So all that's rendered on the fly in color. And you can do that all through just our different tools that we've got. So, and that was cool for me because, you know, I talked about MapBox.js. We met the day before my first day, which is the first time I've ever done that, which is really fun. We met in a coffee shop to talk about what to build, and that was really fun because I had zero experience building with any of these things. I didn't talk about MapBox all day in the talk because it's only tangentially related to the actual, like, process of building with Cordova and Backbone or whatever JavaScript library you want to do. Cordova is really great. I mean, you could just set up a simulation application, that's what you wanted to do. Just use an API. So, yeah.
Awesome.